It is a picturesque setting here in Orem, Utah, 40 miles south of Salt Lake, the site for tonight's NIT quarterfinal round action as the Cincinnati Bearcats have traveled out west to take on the Utah Valley Wolverines for the right to move on to the NIT semifinals. The winner of this game is going to take on UAB, just knocked off Vanderbilt. We've got three of the four teams set for Las Vegas, waiting to find out who will join them. And this is going to be a lot of fun here tonight. Welcome, everyone, to Utah Valley. This place has been going berserk for quite some time. First ever nationally televised game here in this one. Mike Corey, Richie Schuler, both teams having phenomenal runs right now here in the postseason. And Richie, on paper, pretty evenly matched game between these two tonight.
Statistics are eerily similar. Both teams shoot the ball really well. Both teams rebound at a high clip. And both teams do a great job of taking care of the basketball. Utah Valley, though, tremendous defensive team, keeping teams under 40%. Cincinnati, though, will knock down about 9 threes per game. I think it's going to come down to who's the most physical in this contest.
All right, player watch here tonight. First for Utah Valley. They've had a very balanced team. It's kind of hard to key on one guy, isn't it?
It sure is. Trey Woodbury is outstanding. He's 13.5 points per game. He gets assists. He gets steals. He gets rebounds. Matter of fact, the last six games, he's averaged 18 points a game, 8 boards, and 7 assists. He's outstanding. He's tough. He's a playmaker. You see the step-back shots he can make there. He is a deep three-point shooter and a player that has tremendous athleticism going to the basket. But you're right. And now for the Cincinnati Bearcats, though, Landers Nolly, how good has he been? 16.5 points per game. He's been first-team all-conference in the American, a 41% three-point shooter. He's so active without the ball and with the ball. He's got the green light, though. Guy is excellent at getting to the basket, at knocking down shots from mid-range, and hitting some three-pointers.
Welcome to Utah Valley. How about it here, Richie, right? This crowd, pretty pumped up for this one, I think.
This atmosphere is awesome. One of the best crowds I've ever seen here at Utah Valley.
Trip to the NIT semifinals on the line in Las Vegas to the winner. And right off the bat, putting up the three and scoring is Justin Harmon.
Let the crowd speak for us. They're hyped, are they not? This is an outstanding way to start the game for Utah Valley.
Here's Victor Locken going to work for the Bearcats.
Well, you're going to see Utah Valley. They're so good. They get almost 15 points per game in fast break. So transition defense is going to be an issue for Cincinnati, something they're going to have to deal with. Utah Valley, if they're on offense, own the paint, get inside on both ends of the floor. They're so good on the defensive end, blocking shots and getting rebounds. Cincinnati's going to have to deal with that physicality throughout the course of the game.
There's DeJulius on the jumpers. We'll look at the Cincinnati starting five tonight. Locken trying to go after it. He can't. Here's Harmon. Woodbury back for Harmon.
This Utah Valley squad, they like to spread the floor. You got the big fella, number 55, Aziz Bandego down inside.
We got a Guava for Cincinnati. You got Utah Valley coming in here. This game of 27 wins on the season. School record, 27-8. Cincinnati, 23-12. Here's a three from Nolly, who you talked about at the open, and it's out to DeJulius. First bucket for the Bearcats tonight.
See, that's getting offensive rebounds, and that's what we talk about. When we talk about physicality, that's on offense, that's on defense, and that's also rebounding the ball on both ends. The best rebounding teams usually win. In Cincinnati, when they've dominated the boards, they're 20-2 this season.
Only the second ever meeting between these two teams. First was way back in 2010. They try to go inside to Bandego, but you mentioned he's down on the deck. It's a 5-on-4 for the Bearcats. DeJulius, the floater, yes.
And that's making your defense become offense. Great job by DeJulius getting into the paint, knowing that they had numbers. Bandego, one of the best shot blockers in the nation, not back on the defensive end. Attack the paint as much as you can.
First foul of the night, going to be on Nolly. Picks it up for Cincinnati. We've got this Utah Valley team, Richie, coming off big wins on the road at New Mexico, 83-69, and then at Colorado the other night, 81-69 as well.
That's the thing about it, right? Like, here they are in the NIT quarterfinals. They haven't had a home game yet.
Right.
Both games, they had to go against great crowds at New Mexico, and then they go to beat a Pac-12 opponent. I mean, you could go back to last year, and Utah Valley has beaten three straight Pac-12 opponents on the road.
Trey Darthert gets it back up for Trey Woodbury. A long three on the way. It's good. And he's done that all year.
You can't give that young man any space. He's a 6'4 point guard with deep, deep range. Real crafty with the ball to get his open shot. Oh, no. That's going to be a turnover.
Backcourt violation on the Bearcats. 6'4 Utah Valley here early. This Wes Miller in his second season. What a job, right? Getting into this position right now. This team right back to the Cincinnati teams of old, really, yeah, in terms of getting to the NCAA tournament, now the NIT. He tries to get into the semifinals.
And he's done it so differently. They've made 308 three-pointers this season, the Bearcats. That's most ever in Bearcat history. The second most was last year in Coach Miller's first season. So he's brought a three-point barrage attack to Bearcat land.
Offensive rebound, Tim Fuller. Let's talk Cincinnati for a second. How do you deal with the crowd? How do you deal with maybe the altitude, the long trip? What do you got here for the Bearcats?
Well, you know, in the American Athletic Conference, they play in front of big crowds all the time, especially back home at Fifth Third Arena. Look, that's what they do. The three-point shot is the great equalizer. Stick to what got you here. Attack inside. Cincinnati, at any given time, oftentimes has two players that can post up with their back to the basket. They have guys that can attack the paint. If they can get the ball down inside, they're going to be able to kick out for open three-point shots, and they're deadly from behind the arc.
Fuller comes down with it here. Crazy play as Nolly hit that three-pointer for Cincinnati. The floating runner is no good by Darthert, but he got it back. Here's Bandego. Transfer out of Akron. Senegal. What a pickup they got from him. Harmon again inside. No rebound. Locked it.
Push the basketball for Cincinnati.
Nolly, finding the Julius. That's a three, and that's short, but he got it back.
Short on both.
Harmon, got it.
If you're Cincinnati, you want to push the basketball at any given opportunity. You don't want Utah Valley setting up in their half-court defense. They lead the nation in block shots.
And a steal from Darthert to Woodbury.
Oh, my! What a poster!
Oh, settling the crowd down for the moment. Micah Adams-Woods knocking down a three. Funny that we even asked what we thought the crowd might be like here for this game tonight. It's been pretty crazy.
Well, you said it's the first ever nationally televised game for ESPN at Utah Valley.
Yep.
They're hyped to be here. Oh, nice move. That's a mixtape special right there.
Doesn't go. Rebound Wolverines. Fuller got it. Here's Woodbury up to Bandego. How fun is this?
The atmosphere is outstanding. Look at Woodbury with the power slam and transition. And then it's Justin Harmon. Look at the dribble moves, the three-point shot. This atmosphere is electric here at Utah Valley.
Utah Valley hosting an NIT game for the first time in school history. School record 27 wins. Been in Division I for 20 years. You had 5 years as an independent, 5 years in the Great West, and now their 10th year in the WAC.
And they made a great hire in hiring Mark Mattson, a couple of down years, and then a couple of championships to go along with that. Utah Valley. A lot of people, you know, where is Utah Valley? Well, it's 4 miles down the street from BYU. You may have heard of them joining the Big 12. And guess what? The last two times these two squads played, Utah Valley and BYU, who's come out on top? The Wolverines of Utah Valley. Better know who they are.
Yeah, no doubt. And 43,000 students go to the school, the largest in the state of Utah.
Wow. It's amazing. Well, right now, the Wolverines have 8 of their 17 points down inside the paint. They had 6 of those because of fast break. I told you, they're one of the best fast break teams in the country. Cincinnati has to do a better job of transition defense. And because Utah Valley is the best shot blocking team in the country, they affect shots. Beat them down the floor. Don't let Utah Valley's defense get set.
Valley, a step back 3. It's no good. Rebound Bandego for Utah Valley. Woodbury, guarded by Jeremiah Davenport, who just checked in along with Dan Skillings Jr. for Cincinnati. Here's D'Arthur. Bendigo for 3. He's going to set.
Well, he was 4 of 14 from behind the arc, so he can knock it down. If he's wide open, he'll take it.
Davenport. In and out on the 3, and Nolly had a hand on it, but Harmon's got it for the Wolverines. Woodbury in the tank, pitches inside of 4, he got blocked by Nolly, got it back, and he's fouled.
This is what makes Trey Woodbury so dangerous. He's 40% from behind the arc. He always has the ball in his hands because he's the point guard. So if you pressure up on him thinking, I'm going to take away his 3, he'll beat you off the bounce. That makes defense recover onto him, and that leaves a wide open player if the defense doesn't rotate well enough.
He's been so unselfish. He's been moved to point guard. His passing skills are phenomenal. Averaging almost 14 points a game. It was a game in which they beat Stephen F. Austin, a big-time win back on March 3rd, 113-69. Picked up the 3rd ever triple-double in school history. Had 11 points, 11 rebounds, 11 assists. And then they got this guy, Tim Fuller, too. He's at Weber State, 3rd year here now at Utah Valley. Nickname is Roach. He was a pest to opponents, always bugging teams with his physicality and his defense. And you brought this collection of players together, right? Mark Madsen has brought this collection of players together that have been here now for a couple of years together. And you see what it's like when you play with people for a couple of years in a row.
Absolutely. I mean, this is a primetime program. At 27-8. 27 wins in a season. You know, your favorite team hardly ever has 27 wins in a season. A fantastic season they've had. Mark Madsen's just been outstanding.
Previous record was 25. The school wins. Harmon on the step back 3. It's Tiff Denali.
Push the ball through Cincinnati. The best shot blocker's out of the game.
Quick shot there from Davenport. I saw you kind of wondering what was up with that one.
Well, for Cincinnati, making 3s is what's made them successful this year. I mean, this is a 23-12 team. Pretty darn good, right? Finished 4th in the American. But I feel like when Bandego's out of the game, they have just 3 blocks a game. I think in transition, you've got to push it. He's not down there. Take advantage of the fact that he's not there. He's their best rim protector. He's out of the game. See if you can get to the basket. See if you can get fouled.
Well, instead, the Julius palms up another 3. It's no good. Out of bounds off of Cincinnati. There's Manson. In his 4th season for Utah Valley, and he's got his group up 18-10. Under 12 to play in this first half. We'll be back after this. Mark Madsen, a 2-time All-American at Stanford, won 4 NCAA tournaments during his time there, including the 1998 Final Four and the Athletics Hall of Fame there, the graduate of 2000.
It's outstanding, man. Like, you want to talk about a player who gave every ounce that they had. Like, you take a wet rag and you wring out every little drop out of it. That's what they got out of Mark Madsen throughout his entire career.
2-time NBA champion with the Lakers in 2001 and 2002. The only NCAA college coach with 2 NBA titles. And then he went to spend 6 seasons with the Timberwolves after that. And he loves it here. I mean, he has really brought this place back to life in just his 4th season. And you have his parents, Erlene and Dwayne, who are at the game here tonight. This unbelievable atmosphere. Seeing if they're group can move on to the NIT semifinals. And his wife, Hannah, who's expecting their fourth child in just a few days.
I think on Friday or Saturday.
Right.
This weekend. And they're going to have four kids all under 5.5 years old. Busy house. Oh, man. So open.
Bandego is fouled by Davenport.
So Cincinnati came out in the press. And Bandego left wide open under the basket. A miscommunication with your rim protector on the back end of that press.
And we had talked to Mark Madsen about this before. He said his children, William and Leroy, and his daughter, Alexandria, then they're expecting a fourth. This would be his final game, he said, yeah, coaching, because of the expectation of his fourth child and the arrival. So if this team goes to Las Vegas, he might not be there.
Right. He said more than likely that's probably the case. I guess there's that small chance,
sure,
right? So Cincinnati has stubbed their toe here in the early going. They can't break their toe, though. You got to stick with it. Attack the basket. Spread that floor. Look to kick out for open threes. Only have one assist in this game. You look at Utah Valley, four assists to one turnover. Cincinnati's got to get some better chances to pass the ball, kick out for open shots.
Skillings is fouled as he takes it in. Good strong move there. They're going to try to end a drought of 3 minutes and 31 seconds where Cincinnati has not scored. Utah Valley has led pretty much this entire first half. And the lead now is 10.
See, I like that. I mean, Skillings came out. He attacked the basket. There was no fear whatsoever. When you go up against great shot blockers, people are a little timid to attack the basket. Who wants to get their shot blocked, right?
NCAA Men's Basketball Championship continues. Sweet 16 tomorrow. Coverage on TBS and CBS. For more information on game times and networks, go to NCAA.com.
If I'm the Bearcats, I'm looking to attack Bandego. You know, he's got a thin, lean build. Go into his chest. That's what you do. You go into shot blocker's chest. Create some space. See if you can draw the foul. And you also might get a layup because you created that space.
Here's Harmon for Utah Valley as they lead by 8. We play 9 minutes so far here in this first half. Winner to the NIT semifinals in Vegas. Missing on the jumper, but getting it right back. There is Taj Small.
5 offensive rebounds now by the Wolverine.
There's Bandego. Hands it back to Harmon with 5 to shoot. Back inside. Oh, the lob for the slam.
Filthy. They love beating defenders off the bounce, making Bandego's defender come to help. Here it is. It's actually on the pick and roll and lobbing it up. And all you have to do is throw it somewhere near the basket. He can catch it and finish it anywhere. That's a tough angle to catch and slam it home. And Wes Miller and Cincinnati at shoot around today, they talked about those lobs. They were determined not to allow any lobs. So far, Utah Valley's having their way there.
Yeah, I was just going to say, he's not going to be happy with what he just saw right there, because that is exactly right. That was the point of emphasis today in the shoot around. Him and his assistant coach there, and Mike Roberts, saying, yes, no lobs, no lobs. It's so many words, but no. It's tough because they also want to defend that 3-point line, too. They don't want to give up 3-pointers. That's what Cincinnati defense does. They get out shooters.
Correct. Yes, but here's the thing now. You got that, you're guarding that ball screen, right? Bandego sets that ball screen, and then he rolls. So a lot of it comes down to ball screen defense. Now, there has to be help side rotation because Bandego is going to roll to the basket. That's why they lobbed it. So you have, if you get beat off the dribble, you have to have that insurance policy to help. You've got to have help side rotation, and then you have to help the helper. Look, Bandego's got, you know, somebody's got, nobody's in there. You didn't have any Cincinnati player in the paint when the ball is in the air. You have to move on the flight of the pass. You have to be there in time. You can't wait till the ball's already thrown to start your move. You have to be there, anticipate where you need to be in help side rotation.
Officials are at the monitor right now to review as Bandego's got 6 points here. The clock had accidentally started, so they're going to take a look at that, trying to get the time right. That's what they're reviewing right now. Bandego's 2 for 3 from the field. also has three rebounds. And what a great story. It was Mark Madsen who did not end up going to the Final Four last year. Instead, he stayed home, and then he realized that this guy, Aziz Bandego, went into the transfer portal. He was originally in Akron, and he goes and reaches out to him. And then he goes to Akron to meet him. And then him and his assistant coach, Todd Okeson, actually end up going to the Senegal to talk to his family and bring him here to Utah Valley. What a huge pickup for this group this season.
You know, his freshman year, Bandego averaged 3 points per game. That's how good he is. Bandego, third in the nation in block shots, fourth in blocks per game. This is what he can do. That wasn't his man. He was going to help his teammate. He's the insurance policy. His teammate got beat off the bounce, so Bandego's there to help him. He is a true rim protector.
That is his 102nd block of the season. 10-point lead for Utah Valley here halfway through this first half. Davenport, good look for three, and it's just not going down right now for Cincinnati. 2 of 9 from three-point range. No field goals in the last 4.5 minutes, and Skillings comes back to get the steal, but it is recovered by Blaze Neal. Small, and he's fouled by Micah Adams-Woods for Cincinnati. He picks up his first.
One thing that makes Utah Valley so dangerous is they're so good, their players moving off the ball. You teach young players all the time, don't just move with the ball, move off the ball. Most of the time, you don't have the ball in your hand. To get open, you have to find those open spaces to receive a pass. They move off the ball so well, they get ball reversals. They say if you get two or three ball reversals in a possession, you're going to score about two-thirds of the time. They move the ball so well, they get great open looks, and they get high percentage shots.
And it's a group, Richie, that's nice job there from Davenport to knock that pass away. And it's off of Utah Valley, going to be Cincinnati ball. It's been a nice job for Utah Valley, too, this year to be able to stay healthy as well, stay on the court. They had consistency, they had cohesiveness, and a lot of their guys, a couple of them in terms of the starters, have started all 35 games this season.
When they say the best ability is availability, right?
Yeah.
And then, you know, dependability is better than ability.
Skillings, double clutch runner doesn't go, and he got fouled. And it's going to be on Bandego. That'll be his first for Utah Valley.
If you want to get Bandego in foul trouble, attack the basket continuously. Bandego wants to block shots. A pump fake in the air might get him going. Now, he's long. He can recover. But you want to get Bandego out of the game if you're Cincinnati so you can continue to attack without him in there.
Woodbury's back in with Fuller for Utah Valley as they lead by 10. Cincinnati here, 4 of 17 from the field to start this game. 2 of 9 from three-point range, and now 2 of 3 at the foul line as Skillings makes 1 of 2.
What do we talk about in the open? Utah Valley's a tremendous defensive team. They hold teams to under 40% on the season from the field, and only 30% from three. I mean, that is dynamic defense.
D'Arthur. Woodbury. Got it. He looks like a really gritty player, right? You just don't want to go up against a guy like him, do you?
He scores in all three levels. Hits the three, gets to the basket. You saw his athleticism on that slam. He's had a couple of thunderous slams at New Mexico, at Colorado, and now here tonight. And you see the mid-range off the shot fake. I mean, he's an all-around player.
Julius for Lockett. It doesn't go. Right back to Woodbury here for the Wolverines. They lead by 11. On the take, he's fouled. It's going to be Lockett's second. And they got to get him out.
It's a big blow for the Bearcats. Lockett's a shot blocker. He's a double-double guy. He's got 6 on the season. And he's coming off that ankle injury where he missed a few games in February. He's saying about 70-75% back, and they need him. I mean, he's aggressive down inside. He's got mid-range touch. Plays with his back to the basket. We talk about physicality. Lockin's a guy that's really physical for Cincinnati. Right now, Utah Valley certainly has the upper hand when it comes to physicality.
One more for Woodbury. Third straight year, every NCAA Women's Championship game is on the networks of ESPN. For more information, go to NCAA.com, your home for all 90 NCAA championships. Sweet 16 on Friday. Closing out the quarterfinal round of the NIT here tonight. UAB had knocked off Vanderbilt earlier. Winner of this game takes on UAB in Las Vegas. March 28th and 30th for the semis and the championship game. Micah Adams-Woods for three. Tap back out.
After warning, official had to warn Wes Miller, telling him to get back. You're out of the coach's box.
They're going to change the shot clock to 28. The fans not thrilled. They say, okay, but nobody had possession, so it was tapped back out, and that's why Cincinnati was able to go back there and recover it. And here's DeJulius trying to make some moves, being hounded, and now a foul is called on Latrae D'Arthur.
But you see how aggressive and crafty DeJulius is with the basketball. Gets into the paint. He's aggressive. He plays with confidence. See right here. He moves well with the ball. He's trying to beat his man off the balance. Good thing is he's getting in the green. He's getting in the paint. And he kicks it out for an open teammate. And he's third most in Cincinnati history. Or almost third most. He's one assist away coming into the game in Cincinnati history in assists in a season.
And he could do that. That stops a Cincinnati streak of 0 for their last 10 from the field. That bucket finally from DeJulius. D'Arthur, that's a double dribble. And it takes us to another timeout. 7:46 remaining here this first half from Utah Valley. The Wolverines by 10 in the quarterfinals. How about this awesome scene and video taken from our director, Anthony Giassi. This is a C-130 coming over Utah Lake on its way to Provo Airport here in Utah, Orem, Utah. Right down the road from Provo. Outstanding atmosphere here in the West. 25-15. And speaking of outstanding, this crowd here at the UCCU Center in Orem. Look at this place tonight, Richie.
This is awesome, man. This is an incredible atmosphere. Look how excited the fans are. I want to go to the student section. Forget you, man. I'm going over there.
We were contemplating that. That's the look at that. The Green Man Group,
yeah,
in the student section. This is their postseason history for you. Second NIT appearance, first ever time hosting an NIT game, first ever nationally televised game here. And they're basically a bank three-pointer away, yeah, in the Seattle game for being undefeated here at home. They're 13-1 as Nolly drains a three for the Bearcats.
Most road wins in the nation for Utah Valley. And I like this. Wes Miller, whatever he just drew up. After timeout play, they get that three-point shot. That could get Cincinnati back going. It's all about confidence, right? Had a rough start, not shooting the ball well. Utah Valley playing terrific defense. Now, Cincinnati, they can get hot a little bit, make this a game going into halftime.
They need that from Nolly. He's hit two threes. He's got 92 on the season. One of eight Cincinnati players all time to hit 90 or more in a single season. Shot clock is at 5. Woodbury bombs it up again, and that's off, and Nolly's got it.
Push it if you're the Bearcats.
Nolly up top for DeJulius. Just under 7 minutes remaining first half here in the quarterfinals of the NIT. DeJulius, the nice feed is back.
That's what makes DeJulius so good. He has fantastic vision. He's now third all time in single season history at Cincinnati. Behind who?
Oscar Robertson.
The big O.
Right.
Two times.
Robertson with the best marks in single season history with assist, and the third place, David DeJulius.
Fantastic, man.
Pretty amazing.
What a name to be up there with.
Harmon gets it back here for Utah Valley. Right now. 10 points for Harmon in this game. Leads all scorers. 45% shooting for Utah Valley, 32% so far for Cincinnati in the first frame, and a foul is called on the Wolverines.
We keep talking about David DeJulius. He can knock down a mid-range shot so well, but if you recover to him, look, just dumps it down inside to Azikpe. When you have good vision like that, you can be so dangerous. You have good vision, and you can deliver that ball, they say, on a silver platter, right where your teammate wants to catch, receive, and finish.
I thought your point is taken well here, is that if you're Cincinnati, if you could just kind of hang on a little bit here, weather this crowd and the atmosphere, get to halftime within striking distance or tied, or even maybe a potential a little bit of a lead. You know, you've done a really nice job. As Nolly drains a three, because this place has been bonkers tonight for Utah Valley.
Correct. And that's how you can do it. Like I said, the three-point shot's a great equalizer. They just knocked down two in the last two possessions. Two of the last three possessions, they scored in the last three since that timeout.
That's where all Nolly's points have come from, the three-point line. He's got nine. It's now a four-point game. Bandego. Got it.
He likes that little slide dribble move. He's kind of moving with his opposite hand, going inside the paint, kind of yo-yoing the defense, trying to make them fall asleep, and he uses that hook, always going over that left shoulder.
DeJulius, foul, almost got it, and it's going to be on Taj Small.
Bandego, I just think he's impressive. 7 foot, 230 pounds, he has that length, see a little dream shake like Hakeem Olajuwon.
Yeah.
Went to his right, then he went to his left. He can go over either shoulder, but he's better over that left shoulder with the right hand. And now look, with this free throw here, this is four straight possessions the Bearcats have scored.
David DeJulius has been in these type of games. He's the leader, settles his team down. Good job to get to the foul line with the hardest workers on this team. Knocks down both free throws. Second straight year in all AAC, third team selection for the Bearcats.
Bearcats have cut to four. I mean, Utah Valley was up 12 at one point. Chipping away, weather in the storm.
They were up 12 with 8 minutes and 41 seconds to go in this first half. 25-13, Woodbury right back to the rack. He was recruited here by Mark Pope and then decided to stay when Mark Mattson became the head coach here at Utah Valley. He missed all of last year with an ACL injury. He's just done a phenomenal job to work his way back, and what a season he's had.
Yeah, he missed the whole regular season last year, came back and played two games in the WAC championships, and he's had a phenomenal season this year.
Fuller working on Davenport, trying to feed the cutter, and it was Small. He got it back.
Pulled out, reset.
Small for three. And Woodbury, will he be called for the foul? No, it's going to be on Cincinnati.
Bowling pins.
It's on Victor Lockett.
Is that three now on Lockett? How about this three-point shot? Look at Lockett, number 30, tied up with Bandego. He falls to the ground first. Bandego falls second. And I understand why Wes Miller had him in the game with two fouls. Had to have him. He's the most physical player that Cincinnati has. Has to have him in the game against a team like Utah Valley. But now with a third foul, I don't expect to see him until the second half.
Well, yeah, I mean, you answered my question right there before I had a chance to. I mean, now you're right. What's going to happen with this guy here, Bandego? Who's going to be able to check him?
It's a great question. You notice I'm speechless right now. But, you know, they're going to move. Davenport can guard big down inside. I mean, probably Azikpe, number one, Bearcats, plays down inside the paint.
And Bandego with both free throws, 10 points. That was the seventh Cincinnati team foul. And he converts some big ones, puts the lead up to eight. He said offensively, take the ball in the hole. Got to get some contact there, maybe on Bandego.
This is good. This is good offense right here by Cincinnati. They've got two or three ball reversals already. Now attack.
Nolly tries to attack. leads in, dumps it inside. Zikpe. It's a loss to travel.
Traveled. You know why I think he traveled? He saw the big fella. He's going for the reverse layup. Whoa! Three blocks a game. We've got a ball game here, do we not?
That's right, Kevin, Seth. I know, I was going to say there's not that many seats to be had here tonight in this environment here at the UCCU Center in Orem, Utah.
Packed to the brim, man. This atmosphere is incredible.
Winner moves on to the NIT semifinals in Vegas. Small had it, stolen away as Zikpe. He's got Micah Adams Woods. He takes it himself.
How about that? Making your defense become your offense, getting a layup on the other end. It's, you know, got to give credit to Wes Miller's team. You got down in double digits early. You stuck with it. There's a reason Cincinnati gave him a contract extension in only his second season through 2029. Second most wins of any Cincinnati coach in their first 2 years, 41 wins in 2 years coming into this one.
And tried the lob again, a little bit too high for Bandego. Here comes Nolly. 3 minutes to go in this first half. To Julius, the step back. Yes. That's a two ball.
The Bearcats are coming alive, right? It's a much different game when shots from the outside are dropping.
That's 10 points for DeJulius. He's 4 of 10 from the field, the lead Cincinnati. Three players have scored 10 for Utah Valley so far here in the first half. Woodbury's one of them. And now he's got 12.
I thought he got fouled on that too. That was gorgeous. He beat his man off the bounce. If he didn't feel like he could complete that play, he had a dump pass or a lob to Bandego.
DeJulius again. Does it again.
It's a primetime player. All conference in the American. I love his stat line. Over 3 assists for every turnover. So you have to guard him as a guy that's a playmaker, but he will score. He will shoot it. He'll drive on you. He'll do it all.
And this is out of bounds to Cincinnati.
David DeJulius. Love what he's brought. Michigan transfer. So looks like he's going to drive baseline, and he has the step back mid-range shot. And then over here, Trey Woodbury beats his man off the bounce. It's 2-on-1, but he feels like he can finish around a 6'8 player. Again, Woodbury only 6'4.
DeJulius again. Leading in, trying to draw contact, doesn't go, and out of bounds is Oguama.
You know who Trey Woodbury reminds me of, though?
What do you got?
Sam Merrill. Sam Merrill graduated from Utah State like 4 years ago. Just signed a 2-year deal with the Cleveland Cavaliers. But Woodbury at 6'4", Merrill was 6'5". Both played the point guard spot. Could both shoot lights out. Reminds me a lot of Sam Merrill.
Pretty good comparison. Here's Tim Fuller, and he scores it for the Wolverines as they go up 6. Coming up on a minute remaining first half. Nolly, that could be big. In and out. Davenport on the hand of the offensive rebound. Skillings pushes it to Oguama. Back to Nolly, and the second try is no good as well.
So some people, oh my, how is, oh, oh my! Oh! Wow! Beyond half court, alley-oop pass. He's raising the roof in here.
Harmon to Fuller from three-quarter court. Are you serious? Nolly. Somehow. That was unreal. I'm not going to say you've never seen him,
oh,
I've not seen it this year, that's for sure.
You know that SportsCenter top 10.
Yeah.
All right, they get the last shot here.
15 seconds remaining in this first half, and what a fun one it's been.
Kevin Connors, Seth Greenberg standing by in the studio. Halftime report coming your way. We got 5 seconds left. Woodbury up top. Neal. Messi down the three. That's the end of the first half, and it has been awesome here in Orem, Utah. Utah Valley, the Wolverines, led by Trey Woodbury, 12 points tonight. Three players in double figures in scoring. They're 13-1 at home this season. A win tonight, they're on to the NIT semifinals in Vegas. And then got a 6-point lead here at the half. Utah Valley 39, Cincinnati 33. First half of action here in the quarterfinals tonight, the NIT. Let's go back to the studio now. Kevin Connors, Seth Greenberg for the halftime report, guys. We welcome you back to the quarterfinal round of the NIT from Orem, Utah. It is Utah Valley and Cincinnati. The Wolverines lead by 6 as the second half is upon us. Mike Corey, Richie Schuler, how fun was that first half? Utah Valley led by as many as 12. Their lead is now 6. This guy Woodbury had a game-high 12 points.
It was outstanding. It was one of 3 players for Utah Valley to score in double figures. Look, they did a great job with their transition. They got 8 fast break points. They got 22 points in the paint. Cincinnati has got to be better at defending that. For the Bearcats, their shot's going to drop, but they have to keep attacking the basket, get fouled, see if they can get to the foul line, and then use those kick-out for 3-point shots.
So Trey Woodbury with the 10 or 12, and David DeJulius also had 12 in that first half for Cincinnati. As his pass at the top is intercepted, Justin Harvin.
Oh! Wow! Incredible! This team is so athletic.
How about that to start the second half for Utah Valley? Lockett. Got it. He had those 3 fouls in the first half. And a sit for the final 4 minutes plus back in the start of the second half.
They need him. He has an array of post moves down inside. He can be a difference maker for the Bearcats. Good job down inside. He had 16 points in 28 minutes in the last game at Hofstra.
There's Harmon on the feet from Bandego inside, and he can't get it to go. And Lockett is fouled by Fuller.
Get a deflection, you get a steal. Look what it ends up being. This is great job by Harmon. He created the steal. Look at the two-hand flush in traffic. With defense around, it takes a lot of courage to go up like that, knowing there's a guy right behind you that can block your shot.
One other thing in that first half too, Richie, is that Cincinnati had 10 turnovers. They average only 10.7 a game. They got to keep that in check here in the second half.
Definitely do. You cannot take better care of the basketball. Utah Valley will make you pay, as you just saw there by Harmon.
Malley pulls up and hits. He's got 12, they get 13 points now for Cincinnati as he leads them in scoring, 5 of 10 from the field.
Bearcats just keep hanging around. If you're Utah Valley, you can't give Cincinnati confidence. They make a 3 or 2, man, it could be a long second half.
D'Arthur in and out on the 3, and Odio Guama's got the rebound for Cincinnati. I agree with you. I mean, you felt like with all this energy and the exciting plays and the things you've seen from Utah Valley, you feel like they're up 15 points. It's only a 4-point game.
That's exactly my point. Utah Valley winning on the road in the first 2 rounds of the NIT. Now they got their home crowd behind them.
Now he misses, locking the offensive rebound. Now what a feed. Lock in, and he's fouled. And he wants goaltending. They got it. They count the basket.
Oh, wow.
Goaltending, and he was fouled, so he's got the chance for the 3-point play as Tim Fuller picks up his 2nd for Utah Valley.
Incredible look. Great pass down inside by Nolly. And that's exactly what they were missing with his 3 fouls early in the first half, Locken. Now he's back in the game. 3-point play could cut it to 1.
That's a great call, too, as Bandego grabbed the rim, put his hand through it there. So that was basket interference, and Locken can't convert the 3-point play, but it's a 2-point game here.
Look at this right here. Now, that was mishandled by Harmon, but Utah Valley gives you no time to rest. On defense, as soon as the ball goes through the net, or as soon as Utah Valley rebounds, you better get back. They are looking to advance the ball with the pass. You tell me, is it faster to dribble the ball up the floor or pass it?
Right, and it pass that ball up.
So good at looking up the floor and finding open teammates down the sideline.
Well, geez, Harmon threw it 3-quarter court for an alley-oop to Fuller back in that first half.
It was amazing.
Wow,
Micah Adams-Woods for Cincinnati, feeding Nolley off the cut for the tie. No, tap back out, locking again. Working on Bandego, he's got the three fouls.
Beautiful.
And he scores it.
Beautiful. And he's so good with his footwork, you don't know which direction he's going to go. He's going against the best shot blocker in the NCAA, and he scored around him. Oh, look at this. Look at this.
The Julius almost stole it away from Bandego, and he knocks it out of the hands of Woodburn.
You're seeing Wes Miller's group come out here on defense, forcing Mark Mattson to burn a timeout. Three deflections on this possession, but look at Locken on the offensive end. Goes around Bandego, finishes it, and now we have a tie ball game.
And I said when Locken had it that he has the three personal fouls. You got to watch out being called for an offensive, right? Two trying to plow your way in. It's a great body control on his part.
Yeah, at the same time, though, I'm looking to attack Bandego. And look, Cincinnati is not going away. Look at a tie ball game. This is awesome.
Well, Cincinnati hasn't been out here in a while since 2003, the NCAA tournament in Utah. Last regular season game in Utah way back in 64, but they better get used to it because joining the Big 12 next year, they're going to take on BYU, who's also entering the league, and BYU just 4 miles away here from Utah Valley and dealing with that elevation yet again.
I know, the altitude. Yeah. Everybody says, what does that mean? It's a little harder to breathe in high altitude like this. You know what I mean? So you're sucking wind a lot of times out there on the floor, or even laying in your hotel room at night. I'm having a hard time breathing sometimes.
Here's your elevation difference for you. As Cincinnati has the ball now, has a chance to go in front as Nolley was fouled. I'm going to call it on Woodbury, who picks up his first. I want to correct something I said earlier, that Cincinnati only has 5 turnovers in this game right now. They average 10.7. So not as grave as I had said earlier coming out at halftime, but boy, they've really done a nice job of responding here in the second half.
They force Utah Valley into a turnover. They have 2 offensive rebounds. They've taken 3 more field goal attempts than Utah Valley as a result. Look at the fast break.
Woodbury to Harmon. Back alive here as they go back up 2 as Nolley misses, rebound. Darthard on the run, then it knocked out of his hands. Stays with Utah Valley.
Look at though, the shot goes up by Cincinnati. Watch, does anybody in a black uniform get back on defense? No, they don't. Harmon leaks out after the rebound, and he's wide open. You have to have at least 1, maybe 2 get back guys. And Cincinnati just had a mind lapse right there. Left it wide open for a dunk.
Well, it's a great point, too, and nobody was even going for the offensive rebound either, so they're just kind of standing around on that one.
If you're going to be aggressive, you got to get somebody to get back on D.
Fuller, the offensive rebound for Bendigo, and he misses. They're going to say it was deflected out by Cincinnati.
Davenport by Cincinnati says it was deflected off of him, that it shouldn't be Bearcats basketball.
The crowd and Coach Mattson want a foul. Let's take a look at it.
What do you think right here? Look, Bandego's going to miss the dunk. Who to go off of? That went off Bandego, in my opinion.
I agree with that. Probably could have been a foul. Instead, it's going to be Fuller that takes advantage of it down low.
You can't let that get you down if you're Cincinnati. Wes Miller's group has come out and really played well. 4 second chance points here in the second half. They had only 7 all of the first half.
DeJulius slashing his way to the hole. Basket and a foul. Look out.
It's exactly what Cincinnati needed. Keep attacking the basket. Those 3-point shots are going to come when they start cutting this off. But it's very hard to keep a guy like DeJulius in front of you. Great offense by the graduate.
Fuller picks up his 3rd personal foul. He's out. DeJulius trying to cap off the 3-point play, and he does with 15 points. That leads all scorers in this game. It's back down to a 1-point ball game. Harmon to the hole. Blocked. And fouled by Oklahoma as Harmon hit the deck hard.
Well, we said all along, especially coming into the second half, Cincinnati has to protect the paint better. Gave up 22 points in the first half there. In plays like this, now Harmon got fouled hard. Now look, if you're going to get in the paint, don't let them get a good shot off.
Harmon, what does he like to do prior to games and also in his off time? He's a drummer. His parents got him a drum set to play in the church choir. So I got him to go to church. And now he gets the green drumsticks and does this before games on the road, right?
Yep.
And then plays on the opposing team's pep band's equipment.
Hyping up his team. This is not a shoot around. We said, did you play the drums at Colorado in the last game? He goes, yeah, there was a drum set there I played, but there was no cymbals. He was really bummed out. There was no cymbals.
His dad is a preacher, Lorenzo, his mother, Stephanie. That was a good investment. Pass knocked away for the moment by Woodbury. Micah Adams-Woods for Cincinnati. Dumps it inside of Guama. Stays with it.
If you saw Bandego have his hand straight up in the air, he tried one time to get a shot, could not. And then a second time, Oguama goes out. Look at Bandego's arms. That wingspan is so high, and he's perpendicular to the floor. Daring him. I dare you to try to shoot over my long-stretched arm.
Can't do that. That was perfect defense, too, as you're right. He was straight up, too. It was a daunting task, for sure. 5 minutes gone by, second half. Foul is on Nolly. It's his second for Cincinnati. How about Nolly and Justin Harmon for Utah Valley? They played with each other at Curry High School back in Chicago. We talked to Harmon about this before the game, and he said, yeah, he was shooting, right? He was a six-man off the bench. He took the most shots out there. But he could tell that he was going to be a really good one for his career. And that's going to be an offensive foul on Woodbury. So these two, with Harmon and Nolly, meeting up again here in this NIT quarterfinal matchup.
This is a great call by the official. Defense is locked in. Woodbury trying to create space. I think it's a great, great call. You see the arm going out, trying to create space so Woodbury can get a shot off, but he pushed off.
Cincinnati, chance to tie or take the lead with a three. Nolly trying to draw contact. Grab one, a foul. Nolly wants it back. There it is. Nolly and Harmon going at each other. They're going to call Harmon with a foul. And he needs to be restrained there as he's upset. And Dago holding him back. Nolly's saying, yeah, I got pushed, but you can tell the intensity here tonight.
It's like a backyard rivalry. You know, you just talked about how they played together in Chicago. Now they get a chance to guard one another. This is awesome.
And Julius puts it up. No, Woodbury's got it. Bendigo with a Guava on him.
Look how far out he's got him. He's got him almost all the way into the three-point line.
Shovels it into Harmon. No good. Fighting for the offensive rebound. Ethan Potter's got it for the Wolverines. Bendigo. No. Nolly with a rebound.
It's a little helter-skelter. I like what Mark Matz is doing right now. Rebound is made. He's telling his team, relax, calm down. Dribble the ball up. Let's get back under control.
It's intense here tonight. Winner to the NIT semifinals as Woodbury trying to get it to Bandego. And it's going to be out of bounds to Cincinnati when we come back. Experimental rules here in the NIT. Timeouts under 17, 14, 11, 8, and 4. We've got a media break. We'll be back. Here's the story for Utah Valley tonight. These four players have all the points for the Wolverines.
Isn't that amazing? And they started out so hot. But they've since cooled down. And Cincinnati's done a good job of kind of turning the tables a little bit. They're scoring down on the point now. They've already scored 8 points in the paint this half. You see Latrae Darthard right there, number one. He averaged 14 points per game in regular season. In WAC play, He was 17 points per game tonight. 0 for 3 for Utah Valley. That's the one missing scoring link Utah Valley has had. He's only taken three shots, but he is a fantastic defensive player. So he is absolutely contributing to his team's success tonight.
And he has been so consistent. He has started and played in all 36 games for Utah Valley this season.
First team all whack this season.
Here's Lockett on Bandego. Way too strong. And a fight for it. Oh, save from going out. Nice job there by Potter. Last time Cincinnati led was with 17:55 left in the first half. It was 4-3. It's been all Utah Valley, but the lead is only two. Stays that way for the moment.
I tell you, Cincinnati in the second half has been more aggressive offensively, getting to the basket, but much better defensively, especially in stopping transition and making Utah Valley play this half court.
They've made it work a little bit harder, but this time it's Small puts it in for the bucket. Skillings, no, locking the offensive rebound. Oh, they're going to call for the travel.
That's tough to live with as a coaching staff. You want your teammates, your players, to attack offensive glass. Rebounding is the one area in basketball where you can absolutely show how tough you are. And you see Locken, watch him, number 30, coming from almost the perimeter, sprinting in there, getting the offensive board, giving everything he has, and gets bumped a little bit, and they call the travel.
I can understand how Wes Miller had a little bit of a gripe there. He felt like he got pushed, and the reason why that Locken traveled, but didn't get the call. 4-point lead here for Utah Valley. D'Arthur, there he is, Richie. First points of the night.
They can get D'Arthur going. Utah Valley's going to be real dangerous the last 12 minutes here.
That was a big shot. 7-point lead here for the Wolverines. Nolly leans in. Follows his own
beautiful shot. Now you better get back and look. Utah Valley usually takes that in the net, and they have somebody up the floor ready to pass it to.
Five-point game. Nolly's got 15. Backdoor Small.
What I say about Utah Valley moving so well off the ball. High IQ basketball this team is.
That was Fuller on the assist. Great feed. Have another timeout coming at the under 11 mark here in the second half. 5 media timeouts in NIT second half action. Experimental rule this year as Nolly drains another 3. And there's our timeout. 10:57 remaining. The Bearcats, no pun intended, clawing their way back. Down 4 here in the quarterfinals.
It's the little things that make a big difference in basketball. And this moving off the ball by Taj Small, the presence of mind to pass him the ball to the basket, that's why Utah Valley leads so far tonight.
53-49 Utah Valley with just under 11 minutes to play here in the quarterfinals of the NIT as the women's basketball championship heat back up again on Friday. Sweet 16 matchups. Miami and Villanova, that's at 2:30. How good is Angel Reese and LSU? She only had 25 points, 24 rebounds, and 6 blocks in the last game. Taking on Utah, that's going to be an awesome matchup at 5. And speaking of great players, Caitlin Clark in Iowa as they take on Colorado. That's at 7:30. And Ole Miss and Louisville all coming up on Friday in the NCAA Women's Basketball Championship. Sweet 16 action on ESPN, the ESPN app.
It's incredible. Fantastic basketball all the way around.
It's a great week.
This is awesome.
Yes. Utah Valley possession with a 4-point lead. We had mentioned D'Arthur, who did not have any points in the first half, has the 1 3-pointer here in the second half. Now 5 players have scored. All 5 starters with the Wolverines as Locken misses. Rebound. A foul is called. Small had the rebound. Got pushed. Not Skillings.
Hey,
Darthur goes out, and Coach Matson had said that he feels he was the most professional collegiate player that he's been around. Pretty high praise, you know, for his talent, the junior there.
Talks about he's always getting up extra shots, and they say he's the first one before games to get up shots in the gym. At the same time, he's always the last one to leave after practice is over.
Trey Woodbury's been able to get up shots here in this one. He's 6 for 10 from the field, 14 points, back to a 6-point lead for Utah Valley.
Cincinnati just one drawn foul away from being in the bonus. So that shows they're attacking.
Lock in. Not able to get those inside here tonight, Rich. He's got pretty good looks.
He's got really good mid-range touch, you know, and he's still not back to full health after that ankle injury he had back in February.
Well, it's his entire body, right? They said pick a body part, basically, in what he's been dealing with right now, getting the help from the training staff. And Woodbury again. Lost.
Yeah, people don't understand how physical it is down inside the paint. You're getting hit somewhere every time you're playing offense or defense in the paint.
Valley, there's Lockett, and he follows it up and in.
That's what they need to do a lot of. Continuing to get offensive rebounds. They've done a great job of that. That's 12 offensive rebounds now. 15 second chance points for the Bearcats.
And Lockett played hurt in his 33rd game of the season on the 36th Cincinnati has played this year. Ball inside is Fuller. Foul.
All right, now Cincinnati's best offense is getting second chances. First shot doesn't go in. Get your team another opportunity when the defense isn't set to attack or get a putback layup.
They got a Guam on the foul, and here's Tim Fuller to the free throw line. Stepping it up here tonight. Double figures now with 10 points and the 7 boards, as you saw. All of these Utah Valley players have said, and we talked to numerous ones, Harmon and Woodbury before this game tonight, they said this is the best culture they've been a part of.
I believe it. You know, Mark Matson might be one of the nicest human beings you'll ever meet. But he's got these guys coached hard. Now look, Cincinnati, shot's not dropping for him great. They've hit 5 threes, but man, they're what, 5 of 19 from behind the arc. I mean, they're going to drop. I have a feeling these shots are going to drop towards the end of the second half. They keep attacking like that, and that's what Bandego does for you. So excuse me, they are now 5 of 17, Cincinnati, from behind the arc. But this is what Bandego does. Look, they get a second chance, exactly what they want. They attack, and Bandego is the help side defender. He's the insurance policy when his teammate gets beat off the bounce.
You said it, the long wingspan coming out and be able to reject that shot as DeJulius misses. It's out of bounds to Utah Valley. Such a presence inside.
I will say, and we're sitting here courtside, these two teams, they look tired. You know, this is the end of March. You know? And they're tired. And here for Cincinnati, they're playing an altitude where that does a number on your lungs. Coming off 2 road wins is Utah Valley. It's going to be a gritty finish.
Agreed. Lockett on the rebound. Outletting quickly, Micah Adams-Woods. DeJulius for 3.
Nice tired legs being short.
I agree with you on that.
You can get some shots at the foul line. You can really make a difference. You get a little more rest before you knock down that free throw.
Next dead ball is a timeout. Woodbury up top. Fuller!
How many lobs are we going to see tonight?
More than Coach Wes Miller wanted, that's for sure, as Micah Adams-Woods misses, and it's going to be out of bounds to Utah Valley when we come back. And the home team with a 7-point lead at 7:37 left.
This is an awesome move to the basket. Woodbury seeing Fuller, who's calling for the basket. He's got his hand up, thrown up there. Going to take this and hammer it home. Utah Valley in control here in the second half.
How about leading the charge, the president, Dr. Astrid Tumenez, here at Utah Valley?
Does your president do this?
Right.
Really? I love it.
He's having a blast, and why not? And her team tries to get to their first ever NIT semifinals with a win here tonight. Three teams already set, North Texas and Wisconsin. UAB gets the winner of this game here tonight, semifinals on March 28th, and the championship March 30th at Orleans Arena in Las Vegas.
UAB's head coach Andy Kennedy spent some time under Bob Huggins, then was the interim head coach. Led the Bearcats to the NIT. Now, if the Bearcats can pull this out on the road, it'll be Andy Kennedy versus former team.
How about that?
The NIT semis.
7.5 remaining here in the second half. Woodbury for three.
That's pro level, man.
To Julius. No, small of the rebound.
Gonna push it. That's, oh man, look at this. Oh man.
Fuller. This crowd is just waiting for another big play here as they have a 10-point lead. Largest of the game is 12. Shot clock at 5. Fuller got knocked out of his hands by Lockett. Nolley sails it past Mike Adams Woods.
That 3-point shot by Trey Woodbury. Look, this is pro level, man. Look, he comes off the screen, gathers his feet, and gets the shot off before the defense recovers. Oh, man.
And then a foul underneath by Lockett.
Utah Valley moves the ball up the floor so fast, we can't keep up. We got the ball up the floor so fast. Bendigo got blocked at the rim, but the foul is called.
That is now 4 on Victor Lockett. 6:35 remaining in this game.
Bendigo, big old smile on his face. His teammates, every single one of his teammates voted him the hardest worker on the team.
How impressive is that? The WAC newcomer and defensive player of the year in the conference. First team selection as well.
Bendigo, finalist for the Lefty Drizel Defensive Player of the Year Award.
Justin Harmon told us earlier before the game, he said he was kind of a quiet guy. He's like, oh, I opened him up. You know, I told him, I said, hey, we're all in this together, man. We're going to have a great season.
Yeah.
He's really got him playing up to his highest potential, doesn't he?
Yeah, absolutely he does.
And now he's part of this group. He tries to make history for this team. The 20th year in Division I. 10th year in the WAC. It'll be their first ever appearance to the NIT semifinals. Already have a school record 27 wins and counting. That's a tense.
No, that's a clock issue.
I was going to say. Yeah, he said, hold it up. As the clock did not start, I was going to say, got it up there pretty quick. Saturday's women's basketball championship, Sweet 16 matchups, as we'll get you to those. We start on ESPN. We've got the 2-3 matchup, Maryland and Notre Dame, then UCLA and South Carolina. And following that up, the 4th-seeded UCLA. Another 2-3 matchup, Ohio State and UConn, 4 o'clock, and Tennessee, Virginia Tech at 6:30. That's on Saturday for the Sweet 16 in women's basketball.
To pass.
Back inside to Julius. They swing it around. Davenport puts up the 3-ball. That's no good. Offensive rebound to Julius. The floating runner is.
More second chance points.
Yes.
Look, here's the thing. If Cincinnati is making a few more 3-point shots, they're 5 of 19 right now. And they're 26%. They're a 36% 3-point shooting team. They made 2 or 3 more of these 3-point shots, it'd be a completely different game. They're just struggling from behind the arc. Sometimes you just have those games. And that's where the Bearcats are at right now.
Durther missed on the three to Julius again. Another step back, and that one is short as Vandego clears it out.
Smart. Utah Valley knows when to slow it down. There's been times they've sped it up here. They recognize, just walk the ball up. You have a little bit of a lead. You're comfortable, and that's going to be an offensive foul. It's exactly what Cincinnati needed.
Durther picks it up. Proud to see it right behind us, Richie, literally on top of us this room.
Here it is, Durther. I mean, look, he used his shoulder. He extended with his right arm a little bit as he tried to drive baseline. I mean, look, good defense. Good defense by Cincinnati.
I love the fan support here tonight in support of Utah Valley. 6,350 in the UMass attendance. Nolly. Wild one got it.
Cincinnati, they're not going to go away. They're just going to keep chipping away. They're going to pressure you. They have length to force turnovers. I'm telling you, they knock down two or three of these three-point shots, and things are much, much different. So that's going to be the seventh foul now on Cincinnati. So both teams, for every foul now, they're shooting free throws.
Nolly pleaded his case, but you're right. Bonus time here for the final 5-12.
And both these teams shoot 70% or better from the free throw line. So you're going to get a lot of free, easy points.
Utah Valley shooting 74% from the free throw line. And Harmon to the stripe for the 1-1. Exactly 500 points of the season now for Justin Harmon. And now 17 for the game. To tie his teammate Woodbury. 9-point lead. Mike Adams Woods. Oklahoma gathers it.
Lots of time. Don't panic if you're Cincinnati. 14 seconds on the shot clock.
How about Davenport sticking with it? And Skillings.
Oh!
Blocked by Vandego. Skillings stays with it and scores.
They get second chance buckets. 19 points. Second chance now for Cincinnati.
And 16 offensive rebounds as well. We called it. Good point, Richie. Nolly. No, Vandego. Four blocks tonight.
He is such a difference maker. If he doesn't block your shot, he's going to affect your shot. Nobody wants to get their shot blocked. You're going to change the way you shoot the ball because you don't want to get blocked down inside.
But now, 105 blocks on the season now for the sophomore, Aziz Vandego. Who now takes it in on Oklahoma. The tip doesn't go as Skillings has it. Skillings!
There you go.
The freshman for Cincinnati.
Coach Madsen's going to burn one. Utah Valley with a timeout. Now, that's big because it leaves them with one timeout the rest of the game. Great job by Cincinnati. Skillings, great spin move around two people. Give a little bit of that okey-doke and finished in traffic.
Opening night of the NIT.
Look out. In action,
throws it in the air. Sam Houston survives.
Alley-oop. Venters, nerves of steel.
Armstrong all the way to the rim.
Here comes Rutgers again. Straight ahead with Simpson.
Rejected.
Take away. Love it on his own.
Jace Howard, who just has a look on his face like, what am I supposed to do with that?
Kugel splashes home a three.
Dickinson with the dunk.
What did we just see? Oh my goodness.
That's right. Semifinals. Here we come for Wisconsin. and North Texas. Two of the four from last night with their victories on the road. Wisconsin 61-58 over Oregon. North Texas a 65-59 winner at Oklahoma State in overtime. And then earlier tonight, it was UAB knocking off Vanderbilt 67-59 on the road as well. What about here tonight? Who's going to join them for the NIT semis in Las Vegas?
I tell you, if Utah Valley doesn't start cleaning up their defensive rebounding, they're leaving that door cracked for Cincinnati. Cincinnati 10 offensive rebounds in the second half, 12 second chance points alone. They figure, look, we're not knocking down the three-point ball, but we can sure as heck get offensive rebounds and get second chances.
Both teams are the bonus here. Possession arrow favors Utah Valley. If we get a jump, we're coming up on 3 minutes and 20 seconds remaining in this game here tonight. Here is Darth Third. He misses. He's fouled. And it's going to be three free throws as Skillings ran into him for his second personal.
Well, Darth Third has struggled, 1 of 7 from shooting tonight. First team in the WAC. An all defensive team player. See the frustration in Wes Miller's face. It's always frustrating when you foul a shooter. And Utah Valley's doing this without Darthard scoring his typical 14 points per game over the collective season.
That's how good this group is with the team basketball. If one guy's not having it one night, they are very unselfish, right? When you watch this team play, you don't see a lot of one-on-one, let me take over the game, I got to handle it all. It doesn't work that way for this Utah Valley team.
Well, part of it is because they're such a great defensive team. Among the best nationally, okay? It, when your offense isn't clicking, I mean, Utah Valley scored 64 points. We're at the end of the game. That's not killing it offensively. But defense always travels. You're almost always going to have a great defensive game if you're a great defensive team, but your offense will struggle at times. They've held Cincinnati to 35% from the field. That's high level.
Conference Coach of the Year with Mark Madsen, his fourth season. Trying to see if this team can advance to Vegas. In the semifinals, they're 3 minutes and 20 seconds away from that. The lead is 7. DeJulius. No. Rebound Fuller for the Wolverines. Oh, offensive foul. They're going to call it on Bandego. And that's his second. The moving screen.
I definitely want to see that again. That can crush you. It's like an unforced turnover. But now you got a foul. Look, just a little handoff and just kind of like a interference screen.
Nolly comes off the lock and screen. Wants to take it in on his former high school teammate Harmon. Pulls up. No. Woodbury's got it. And he couldn't quite get it to his teammate. It was intercepted by Lockett.
At some point, you got to pick up some full court pressure if you're Cincinnati. Down 5, 2.5 minutes. Now, look, if you're Utah Valley, you're in control. You can use a little clock, but you still have to continue to attack. There's a lot of possessions to play in this game.
That's right. A lot of time left. Harmon up top. Bandego, he blows the dunk. And Davenport runs for Cincinnati. Nolly.
Oh, this would be huge.
Wide open three. DeJulius, no. And Davenport, another offensive rebound. Nolly, no look, lock in.
That's frustrating. Very frustrating. I'd say if you're Utah Valley, pull it out, run some clock. That's exactly what they're going to do.
There's a big miss there from Lockin. Good battling, playing hurt. Bandego now over Davenport, and that's a 4-point swing. Instead of a 3-point game, it's a 7-point game. Bandego's got a double-double, 10 and 10. They get 13 and 10, and now we've got some technical fouls here. It's getting heated. Hang on tight. Minute 25 remaining. official DG Nelson, along with Nate Harris and Amy Bonner, are going to talk it over here, and we're going to come back and tell you what just transpired from Utah Valley. All right, let's take a look at what just happened here. 1 minute and 25 seconds remaining in this game. Left side of your screen to Julius. And then there's a little bit of tassling going on right there with him and Latre Darthard for Utah Valley. And they were right on top of it from the get-go. And you believe double technicals with DeJulius and Darthard as they're still talking it over here at the scorer's table, Richie?
The official told me they wanted to review it, and then they would get back to us on exactly what happened. So let's, you can't have these mental breakdowns at the end of a game like this.
You could see it right from the start there. DG Nelson comes in and says, technicals on David DeJulius and Latre Darthard for Utah Valley.
So class A technicals on both of them. They offset.
Right.
But again, in times like this, you can't have critical errors. It's a 7-point game. Utah Valley's in control. Cincinnati's not out of it yet, though. You've got to keep a presence of mind to not make those errors. Don't let the emotions get the best of you. So it's offsetting. I think they're getting a handle on it right now. So both teams with a new frame of mind. They've met with their coaching staff for the last 2 or 3 minutes. A new plan of attack for Wes Miller's squad. They have to have a shot drop. They get a 3-point shot, they're going to feel really good. But you're going to have to see some full court pressure from Cincinnati. Mark Madsen's group's going to have to withstand, weather the storm, because the pressure's coming. Cincinnati has great athleticism, great length, and certainly get steals and deflection. That's exactly what the Bearcats need to do.
This place has been jumping all night here in Utah Valley, Orem, Utah, 40 miles south of Salt Lake. First ever nationally televised game here tonight. And they've come out to support the Wolverines, trying to make it to the NIT semifinals. Davenport for three, no. Lock it up, it's a rebound. Count the basket, no, what do we got?
Over the back.
It's on Lockett, no basket. Foul, he has fouled out, that's number 5.
That is a crusher for the Bearcats. I believe that's his second time getting an offensive foul called on a rebound. It's exactly what you tell your players to do. Attack the offensive glass. Look at him. He comes from the 3-point line, gets the offensive rebound. And did he give a little push? Yeah, it's a good, great call.
Yeah.
He pushed Bandego in the back to create space because Bandego was going to get that defensive rebound.
Yeah, that right hand right there. You saw it. And so Victor Lockin is fouled out.
That's a big blow for the Bearcats. Shots aren't dropping.
Yeah, I mean, he was 5 for 11 too, but you're right, there's been a couple ones that you wish you could have had if you were Cincinnati. 10 points, 10 rebounds for Lockett. His night is done.
I love his game because he gives it all, and he goes and gets rebounds.
And Bandego, the president, Dr. Astrid Tamines, loves it.
But why is she on the sideline? She should be on the baseline with the cheerleaders. Got the pom-poms.
Right,
push it, push it, push it.
We've seen some crazy stuff, right?
Oh, yeah.
NIT, last second plays. Still time here for Cincinnati. Nolly relocates for three. There you go. 105 remaining, 5-point game.
Pressure the ball, take care of it. Stay calm, trap him, trap him.
Foul's called. Micah Adams-Woods.
That should be 2 free throws. I believe that's the 10th on Utah Valley.
It is automatic 2 at the line here for Darthard.
So now both these teams still have a timeout left. Cincinnati may need it to set up a press. You'd be after a big bucket. You want to try to save it for the last possession, right? Utah Valley's got to knock down these free throws to kind of seal it. But if the pressure is too intense for the Wolverines, Mark Mattson still has that one timeout to burn if needed.
Most he can make it is a two possession game here with this free throw if he hits it. 57.2 remaining. Six-point lead for the Wolverines.
Want to roll it now.
DeJulius. For Oklahoma. Got
pressure. Full court. Don't foul yet. If you can get a trap, force a deflection, even better.
Oh, almost a turnover. Bandego. Clock is running here. 38 seconds.
You got a foul.
And they do. Again, Mike Adams Woods is third. Two free throws coming.
Wes Miller, look at the instructions he's given to one of his players. See, that's the key right there. Look at that save by Harmon. He fell into the stands, but they almost forced a turnover with the Bearcats' pressure. That was a great individual effort by Harmon to save the ball, and now they get another chance at the free throw line.
Got to be careful. Can't run into the president over there. He's wearing on that side.
You lose your scholarship.
Right. Yeah. You're like, but we won the game. But we won. Yeah, if they hit him with the handle.
You hurt the president.
Right. They're able to hang on. 37.4 left.
I mean, look, Cincinnati, they've got to make a big shot. Still have a timeout left. Look, you make it a one-possession game with a three-pointer. Don't have to have it. But, man, would it make a big difference.
Nolly. Who's hit 5 of 9 today from three-point range. There he is. No good. Woodbury's got it.
Got a foul.
They can't do it.
Look at this keep away. Fantastic job by Utah Valley. And it's all smiles here in the arena.
This feels like the championship if you're Utah Valley, right?
Doesn't it?
Oh, man.
And this is the fourth quarterfinal game. It's the last one. Every single one has been amazing. The quarterfinals in the NIT has been primetime March basketball.
Our third.
If you're Utah Valley, you seal this. Don't do anything silly. There's some talking going on. Coach is trying to calm everybody down. Don't get any silly technical fouls. We already saw that a moment ago. Play without fouling. Don't foul a shooter because Cincinnati's got to make three-point shots.
Coach Mattson's wife, Hannah, days away from expecting their fourth child here as she watches on with Utah Valley and Darthard, who was scoreless in the first half. 9 second-half points. 15 seconds away. From moving on to Las Vegas, DeJulius misses the three. Bendigo's got it. He's fouled with just 9.7, and they feel it here in Orem, Utah.
Are we seeing a changing of the guard and the best team in the area? 2-0 against BYU in the last couple of games, and just a few miles down the street, and Utah Valley about to go to the NIT semis with their 28th win.
Wolverines would love you to think that, right?
They would.
And they are proving their point, that's for sure. Mark Mattson. They love playing for this guy, and you can see why.
He coaches like he plays.
Yep.
He played back in the day.
They called him Mad Dog, right, from back in the day, but, you know, it was Justin Harmon, he said, he's the nicest guy I've been around. He's like, he's far from being mad. For his playing day, sure, but he's had this group playing together so well all season long. They are 9.7 seconds away as DeJulius goes to the free throw line here.
I think emotions have gotten the best.
It's a Class A technical foul called on Darthard. which is, again, like you said, Richie, you don't need that. If this game is a, now it's down a 5-point game here. 9.7 seconds, and they go back to the free throws for Bandango. He's got two.
Latrae Darthard of Utah Valley has been ejected.
And he's out, right? Because that's a second.
You have to control your emotions.
Yep.
Whether you're winning or you're losing. Because look at that. Now it's a 5-point game.
9.7 seconds to go. One more here for Bandango.
You have to make 3-point shots. You make a 3-point shot if you're Cincinnati. Burn your timeout, set up your press.
DeJulius. Wessel before that. Get a timeout. Wes Miller called timeout.
All right. So that's their final timeout.
We're going to come back in 30 seconds. Stay right where you are. All right, here's what we got. Cincinnati's out of timeouts. Utah Valley with one remaining, 7.2 seconds to go. It is Cincinnati possession. They just called timeout.
No.
What do you got here, Richie?
Well, you got to get a 3-point shot immediately. All right. It's good. If you miss that 3-point shot, it's game over. You make that 3-point shot, there's a couple of ticks left. You set up your press immediately. They're just 6 of 24 from behind the arc. But you got to make it here, set up your press, get a steal, and get another one. Because if you press after making the 3-point shot, let's say there's 2-3 seconds left,
right,
how are you going to foul? You're down three. Are you going to foul as soon as it's inbounded? Then it'll be down 4 or 5 because they're going to get 2 free throws. You have to get a steal after you make a 3-point shot, and then you have to make it. A lot of things have to go right for the Bearcats for them just to force this game into overtime. If you're Utah Valley, keep your cool. You know, maybe you switch things up. Maybe you throw Cincinnati off by switching on all ball screens and handoffs. Make it difficult. Make it challenging. And maybe throw them off and throw a turnover. Game over.
Cincinnati has led for only 30 seconds in this game. We were tied for 46 seconds, and other than that, it's been all Utah Valley as they attempt to go to their first ever semifinals of the NIT in Vegas, 7.2 seconds away from that. Cincinnati will inbound in the front court. Nolly's hit 5 of the 6 threes for Cincinnati. The other one came from Micah Adams-Woods. He's going to put the ball in play.
So, you know, you need to look for Nolly or DeJulius off a screen. So they're, Cincinnati's coming out in a box set with a side out of bounds play. Somebody's either streaking to the corner or the top of the key for a 3-point shot. Don't be surprised to see DeJulius set a cross screen and then go in between the two screeners at the free throw line. Little elevators, doors closing for a 3-point shot at the top of the key.
Micah Adams-Woods for Oklahoma. Nolly for 3.
That's it.
Right into the hands of Small, and that'll do it. Utah Valley advances to the semifinals of the NIT for the first time in school history.
What a crowd, what an atmosphere. Utah Valley going into the semis in Las Vegas has now won 7 of 8 games. They're red hot. They're a legitimate contender to win the NIT championship. And many would say they'll be the front runner.
And what an atmosphere here tonight inside the UCCU Center in Orem, Utah. Packed house watching their Wolverines beat Cincinnati 74-68. And they will advance and take on UAB. It's going to be on Tuesday, March 28th, the championship. Thursday, March 30th, we'll have it for you on ESPN and ESPN2. And this has been a fun one here tonight. Richie, great work with you, my friend.
It's been awesome, man. And what a game we had. Let's do this again.
Let's do it. For Richie Schuler, Mike Corey, saying so long from Orem, Utah. Utah Valley wins it over Cincinnati 74-68. They're on to the semifinals of the NIT next week in Las Vegas.
Now we send you to Nicole Briscoe and Michael Eads. SportsCenter's next. Enjoy it. Have a great night, everyone.